Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to El Pocho Hour. I'm your host, Noel Uji del Rancho. Today's show is about Indigenism. We're going to cover basically its history as a intellectual, cultural, political movement, its development over time, and really what are the ends of this movement and how it affects us Hispanos or Hispanoamericanos, regardless of your race. So I'm going to start off by going through a lecture by a Spanish academic named Maria Elvira Roca Barrea, and I will put the link in the description in the show notes. Though the lecture is in Spanish, she is a woman who wrote the book Imperiophobia. Janiel, are you familiar with that book?
Imperiophobia, Leyenda Negra.
Fonz,
that's a great book.
You have
that
book.
She also wrote
Roma, Rusia, Estados Unidos, y el Imperio Español.
Did you buy that book?
Yes.
Yeah, I have it.
You can find that in Kindle and in Amazon. She also wrote a book named Fracasología, which I recommend a lot because it talks about the Francophilia of the Spanish Empire, of the Spanish elites, and how we as Latin Americans or Hispanic Americans inherit that Francophilia.
Very interesting. Yeah, she's a really funny, cute lady. She's like a little short lady. She's from southern Spain, so she has kind of a Spanish accent, but it almost kind of blends in with a Cuban accent. So it's kind of entertaining and maybe sometimes hard to follow her if you're not familiar with that accent. But she's a very smart woman, and she went through this lecture. So I'm basically just going to translate some bullet points that I took from it. So let me just start off with that. Indigenism started off as a literary movement in Spanish America. Really started off with novels from Peru and Mexico. It was it was poets and novelists who basically kind of use pre-Columbian motifs or characters in their stories to basically express themselves. So it was originally completely a literary movement. Then it quickly started to grow into kind of an anthropological or ethnical movement. And we've kind of covered this in some episodes, right, where basically the elites of the different republics that inherited the empire, you know, kind of sought myths, national myths, in kind of these pre-Columbian motifs or characters or archetypes to kind of form the essence or the roots of these new national identities that didn't exist before, right? And that's crucial to understand that. So then it started as a literary movement, then it became a anthropological, ethnical movement. And then over the last century, it became a political movement. And it's important to note where this political aspect of it came from, because it developed post-World War II. And it was actually set off by an American named John Collette, who was the minister for the Bureau of Indian Affairs for the United States. So in 1940, he sets up what he calls the Inter-American Indigenous Congress in Mexico City. And that's really known as the dawn of what would eventually become Latin American studies in American universities and the dawn of political indigenism. So what needs to be understood is that the political indigenism that we know today, that we all kind of see, you know, LARPing at the corners or kind of making these brash statements like, I'm not Mexican, I'm not Hispanic, I'm not this, I'm Nicantlac or whatever the fuck. You cannot separate these movements from America and Americans and Anglos. Okay, so that's crucial to understand that without the U.S. government and U.S. academia, this political movement and this academic field of study, Latin American studies, wouldn't exist. So let's go into defining what a Latin American studies is a bit. So essentially, the story of Latin America from a point of view that says that these nations existed before, and let's just use Mexico and Peru, and somehow we have to undo them of their Spanish heritage and recover what was there before. So it assumes that there wasn't a national entity called Mexico before the Spanish came, or Peru before the Spanish came. And essentially, the Spanish just had a momentary occupation of these regions. but that somehow these people had an identity that predates Spain. Which I'll pause a bit here. I think I'd like to open it up to you guys. Poncho, I'm getting a little bit of feedback from you, buddy.
All right. Give me one.
No worries. Again, this is ridiculous to assume that because Mexico and Peru are a product of mestizaje. It is a product of Spain, or what was Spain, mixing with the natives and creating something new. And that is what created these nation states and these identities. And what you have to notice here is that this same line is actually pushed in Spain, in Iberia itself, with the various national groups in Spain now kind of having the same notion where, like, we were Basque or Catalans, and it's the Castilians or the Spanish who kind of came and colonizes and imposed their culture on top of us. Yet this kind of falls into a trap because it's in a sense like saying we colonize and conquered ourselves, right? So it's stupid, yet it doesn't mean that it's any less pushed.
I mean, yes, there's a strong relation between U.S. academics and indigenism. I mean, even Vasconcelos, before World War II, identified that, you know? He even identified how the political problem that indigenism promoted by U.S. academics had, which was basically to de-Hispanize us and to perceive us as these, as you say, as these, like, native entities. But at the same time, I need to, like, we need to emphasize that there was also the post independence
debate. I want to come back to that. We'll come back to that. But what I wanted to emphasize right now, just before I finish this whole summary, is this notion that these nations existed before, specifically.
I think that's ridiculous. I mean, before.
As if the natives had a united identity, as if an Aztec viewed a Mayan as his people more than he viewed a Spaniard, or a Purépecha viewed the Aztec more as his people than the Spaniard. They were both strangers, right? The Aztec and the Spaniard were both strangers.
I mean, pretty much. I mean, the idea, even the Caribs had a saying that was basically "Ana Karina Rota," which means only Caribs are people, you know?
Right.
So I think that's like one of the best example of how natives view themselves within each other.
Yeah, they viewed themselves how humans have always viewed themselves, which is ethnically. They didn't have this racial concept that is very, again, much a product of let's just call it jam culture of Anglo, since they're the main ones who kind of taken this torch on. They didn't view the world as a black, yellow, red, or white. They viewed the world as Caribs, and everybody who's not a Carib is not really a human. So they viewed it ethnically. They didn't say, oh, look, the Arawak is, from an outside perspective, similar to us. Therefore, there are people as well. What a lot of moderns do is that they project this expectation of kind of a racial consciousness that just never ever existed, right? That the Iroquois didn't feel like they were part of the same red race as the Inca. Not anymore.
And what's funny is that the Caribs actually they allied themselves with the Dutch and the British to enslave other native tribes as well.
There's a lot of history about that.
Yeah, yo, where I'm from in Michoacan, right, it's mostly Purépecha. And basically what happened is when the Purépecha heard that Tenochtitlan fell, they basically, when the Aztecs came to ask for help, they told them to go kick rocks. Because they were bitter, bitter enemies. They were always fighting. They were a rival empire. So, you know, they basically told the Aztecs to get lost. That's not my problem. And, you know, they ended up making a deal with Spain. But,
right,
you know, it just shows that, like, they weren't this united front, you know, because you have the Tlaxcala that fought with the Spaniards. The Purépecha told the Aztecs to kick rocks, you know, like...
Yeah, they didn't have. They didn't have a racial identity. You're superimposing a racial identity over people because of a reddish hue in their skin. It's like such an American concept of. It's like, and it's not even racial. It's like skin colorism. You know, like
I mean, it's pretty racist if you think about it.
That almost feels like colonizing the natives over again.
It is. You're imposing a racial identity on people whose racial identity came from their ethnic identity. They didn't separate those two things. They carried on their own languages and cultures and customs independently. You know, they never gave that up. Now, with the Purépecha is interesting because essentially the Purépecha came into the fold by negotiation. You know, I think that's another crucial thing that we need to touch on for the audience. This concept of the Spanish were like these magical warlords with 500 men were able to take these huge empires. And the Indians were just these retards where once they heard the side of cannon, you know, they just ran and hide and never got the balls to fight again. You know, that might happen. That might happen the first once or two times you heard the cannon explode, but once you saw it started killing people, you're quickly gonna go and try to take it out. So what it does, that this whole concept of history that the Spanish were able, you know, just a few men, it spits in the face of history, and it spits in the face of really a conquest that was manned by Indians, right? The Indians did the conquering, right? They're the ones who overwhelmingly did this. They gave up their systems and their programs upon the arrival of the Spanish. Big chunks of them did because it made sense to, right? Like clearly once the Spanish came, these chieftains couldn't for very long keep LARPing like they were deities. You know, like they came to the embarrassing reality of, you know, there is a greater power. Otherwise, how can I explain this to my people? I clearly can't. And they took a knee. Yeah. And became baptized. Go ahead.
And besides that, it was probably like a better system for many of them. You know,
absolutely.
We have. But in regards to what you talk about, how they want to whitewash the history of the conquest, I think that's like when you say that the Spaniards and so on. I think that's the history that some Spaniards want to make. You know what I mean? That they did everything, and that's not true. I mean, the natives collaborated a lot, and I'll say that they were fundamental and they were the corners, one of the most important rocks of the conquest.
Absolutely, in the fall of Tenochtitlan, according to Bernal Diaz del Castillo, who was a contemporary of Cortez, there was 200,000 Tlaxcalan native auxiliaries. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
While the Aztec warriors drawn from the numerous cities, right, the Aztec army was 300,000. So the Aztecs still are outnumbered the Indian auxiliaries. But you're talking about 300 to 500 men that Cortez's party and at the head of a force of 200,000 men. I mean, what would get 200,000... Poncho, I'm getting a little bit of feedback. What would get 200,000 soldiers to listen to a couple hundred? I mean, that never makes sense. Like, there's way... It would make sense if you're talking about 200 and maybe 1,000, and these guys have horses and cannon, but we're talking about 200,000 guys. You could literally just throw 500 guys at them and, you know, sacrifice 500 Indians... And you have the bulk of your army to now have cannon and swords and horses. But they didn't do that.
And the argument of the technological superiority, I mean, it wasn't really a thing, you know?
No, it wasn't. It was more psychological. I mean, yes, the Spanish were more advanced, you know, to an extent. But it's not like they had M16s and endless ammo, right? They didn't have M50s on the back of Toyota Hiluxes. You know, these were Flintstone muskets that weren't very effective, you know, in the kind of this guerrilla warfare that eventually the conquest of Tenochtitlan descended into. It was more a fight of swords versus swords. Now, some of those were made of obsidian blades, but they were no just a club is not that much less lethal than a sword, you know, in battle, especially if I have the numbers that I have that these people have.
There was I think the most important thing about the conquest was the diplomacy.
Yes, it was. That's what has to be understood, that it was diplomacy that convinced the Tlaxcalans to join the Spanish, right? And again, this is the template that Cortez establishes and then is seen throughout the rest of the conquest of the Americas in Guatemala and in Peru and Chile. But let's go on here a little bit. Pedro del Alvarado, when he conquered Guatemala, he took 480 Spaniards and thousands of auxiliaries from Tlaxcala as well. Let me just kind of read through the notes here real quick. You know, some of his, like, one of his victories in 1525, it was 40 Spanish cavalry, 80 Spanish infantry, and 2,000 Mexican and Quiche allies that took the city. So, I mean, you're talking about 2,000 to 120 who really made the conquest happen. And here's what I want to offer the listener, is that it's very easy to say that the Spanish came here and conquered. I think it's oversimplified. I think it actually denies a huge chunk of history, like we're outlining here with the numbers of troops in the actual conquest and how overwhelmingly the troops were indigenous. And this was also the case in the Philippines, right, where a big chunk of the force wasn't just indigenous or Spaniard, but also mestizos from Mexico conquered the Philippines. And Florida, the conquest of Florida, you saw the same dynamic.
And even Mexica, there were some Tlaxcalans going on the Philippines.
Yeah, exactly. They were pure Indians in that conquest. But you kind of have to understand it like this, and I like to use this example of, like, when a car company buys another car company, say, like, Chrysler buys Mercedes-Benz, right? Chrysler's in a cash position and somehow acquires Mercedes-Benz. And now Mercedes-Benz becomes, you know, 40% of sales of this new corporation, call it Daimler-Benz or whatever, or Chrysler-Benz. 40% of the sales are Mercedes-Benz vehicles. Then after a couple years, you know, 70% of sales of this new company are Mercedes-Benz vehicles. So it's like, even though Chrysler bought Mercedes-Benz, now that Mercedes-Benz is actually the bulk of the company, it's kind of like Mercedes-Benz owns Chrysler, right? It's like, and I know that's kind of a mind puzzle, but think about it in the sense of, like, a prisoner is in a prison guard, right? The prison guard is just as much a prisoner because he can't put his guard down, right? He's just as much trapped into this prison as the other guys. And so there's a connection between this and understanding that, yes, even though the Spanish crown, you know, the empire formed under the Spanish crown, the empire in itself, the conquest of the empire in itself, wasn't a purely a Spanish doing. Even if you kind of took apart the men involved in the conquest that came from the old world, you know, obviously there was other Europeans, there was Africans involved in that. So it was never really like Spanish man came and killed a bunch of Indians. It's much more subtle than that. All the major conquests were done largely by Indians.
And besides that, and to make a breach with the theme of indigenism, that the conquest of let's put it this way, Tlaxcalans and all the Mexica people that collaborated with the conquest were co-colonizers, not only in a military sense but also in a cultural sense. The U.S. Southwest, and this is important because Chicanos like to pretend that they're Aztecs, some, you know, yeah, the neo. The fourth Spanish colonization, the American Southwest, New Mexico, Texas, California, they didn't know about Nahuatl or the Nahuatl language, you know?
Sure.
So it was thanks to the Spain and with their Mexica allies that the Southwest, the American Southwest, ever Nahuatl was part of the American Southwest.
Right. So it was like the Nahuatl domain expanded under the Spanish crown, under the Spanish empire.
Exactly. So when these neo-Aztecs, Chicanos, like that like to pretend that they're Aztecs, were in, which is not true, the tribes of the American Southwest were not Aztecs. They were not Mexica. They are affirming the Spanish colonization, and that's a funny thing about the idea of Aztlan. The idea of Aztlan. Aztlan is literally is based in the Spanish, in the viceroyalty of New Spain, you know?
Yeah, if you look at a map of Aztlan, it basically is New Spain, the Kingdom of New Spain. So there is these chunks of history that are overlooked, misunderstood. There's this assumption that everybody from Mexico is descended from Aztecs, which the Aztecs would have been a minority in the present nation state of Mexico. Though the country carries the name of the central tribe, you know, it's like, it's funny because now the movement is called like the Mexica movement, but it's like now you're imposing the Mexica identity over, you know, all these other nations, like, for example, the Purépecha, who explicitly rejected the Mexica and said, kick rocks, like, suffer and die. You know, that ain't our problem. You ain't my people.
I mean, I don't know. I think most Native Americans from the U.S., you know, from the U.S., they view these mestizos, the LARPing as natives, like immigrant mestizos LARPing as natives, as like a funny thing, just like a parody, you know?
I don't know.
They don't like them.
I don't know. We'll expand on that. Let me keep going a little bit forward here, because that's actually a good point you brought up of how real Indians, and where are the real Indians? Do they really still exist in the United States? It's actually kind of interesting, but let me keep going here. So to touch back on Latin American studies, again, it takes this view. It assumes that these entities, that these nationalities existed before the Spanish came. And the reality is that these identities, these nationalities exist as a fusion of the Spanish coming and el mestizaje that occurred with the Indians. So you can't separate Mexico from Spain, and you can't separate Peru from Spain, because the Peruvians are a product, whether biologically or culturally, of this fusion. Same with all their people from Hispanic America or Latin America. So overall, the whole point of this academic study is to create a bipolarity, right? It's like we speak Spanish, but it was an imposed language of the colonizers. And sadly, the Republicettes did compound this bipolarity, which I do want to expand on after this. From the 40s to the 70s, you begin to see political indigenism begin to influence or inform political movements. So you kind of saw it in kind of the attitudes of, like, say, somebody like a Chavez, right, where it's like Spanish bad. But a lot of this stuff was kind of political and rhetoric-based. Same thing you saw it with you know, the Zapatista movement, or even like the Sandinista in Nicaragua, where they kind of took these myths of these rebellious Indians who kind of held out and kind of lionized them as an example. You saw this in Peru too, right? The Tupac Amaristas, where they kind of took these symbols of these, like, you know, these last vestiges of Indian warlords who kind of fought out with the Spanish as heroes. But again, none of these movements to this point are implicitly anti-mestizaje. They're just kind of saying, you know what, I'm going to choose this Indian hero as an archetype. But the real aim behind this movement is the second Balkanization of Hispanoamerica following the first. So the first Balkanization was the breakup of the empire, where vast swaths of territory was essentially lost. Not just in Mexico, Venezuela, a chunk of territory was lost, Guatemala, the Falkland Islands is another example of this. But now there's like a Balkanization 2.0, and you're seeing it with different regional tensions within Mexico, within Argentina. But it's not just now these nation states on a map that are being Balkanized, but it's almost like we ourselves are spiritually and intellectually seeking to be Balkanized. And we have to ask ourselves why. Why would they seek this? And I'll answer this in a second. So one thing that she touches in the lecture is how California and New Mexico and Texas was lost in 1848. And with that, basically began to erase the history of the area before the Anglos came. And so this is actually really interesting to understand what happened to the populations and the peoples of the of what would be the southwestern United States before the Anglos came. So it has to be known that when the Spanish came and basically dealt with a nomadic tribe that didn't have cities or towns, it wasn't sedentary, the Spanish recognized their land right. They were allowed to keep all the land that they used. And the Spanish offered, in specifically around Arizona, around the Apache areas, the Spanish basically told them, if you guys settle the land, we'll help you settle the land and we'll recognize the land that you're settling. Because up until that point, it was just like a nomadic crossroads. There were no settlements. So in a sense, nobody owned the land because they were constantly moving around in the land. And the Apache didn't come to, they didn't come to settle the land until the Spanish basically made them that offer. And so then that's when you get a lot of these Apache leaders had Spanish names and they were actually baptized. Geronimo is an example of this man. Because Spain had recognized the Apache land before the Anglos came, now they came into conflict with, actually they also came into conflict with the Mexican government, but they further came into conflict with the American government because they're feeling like, hey, we already have our land. We're recognized. This is our land. You can't take us off of it, right? The Spanish already recognize it, and yet the Anglos didn't care. They were, you know, marginalized, persecuted. That's really the true genocide that happens. Yet Latin American studies overlooks this chunk of history and posits that the real problem of the Indians of the region came with the Spanish. That's really the root of these people's problems. It wasn't what the Americans did. It was what the Spanish did. And they don't even mention what the Americans did. But I'll give you a quick example. When California was conquered by the United States, there was 150,000 Indians, right? In 1848, there was 150,000 Indians. 40 years later, there's only 16,000 Indians. So throughout the years of the gold rush and after, the population was dwindled by over 90%. Now, it has to be understood that these Indians of these regions had largely began to Hispanicize. Again, I gave you the example of Geronimo. They began to be baptized. They began to settle the land. They began to form cities and agriculture. And essentially, once they kind of began to catch steam, here come the Anglos and basically destroy that whole entire progress. But it must be noted that even till this day, Spanish has never stopped being spoken in these lands, right? There was an interesting story that she actually shares in the lecture where she meets this, I don't think she was Apache or Navajo academic, you know, who obviously looks very Native American. And she's like, I'm tired of people asking me, when did I immigrate here? She's like, I didn't emigrate here. I'm a native from here, because they assume she's Mexican, right? She's like, the United States came to me. So it has to be understood that these people were already being Hispanicized. They were already beginning to form communities in more of a modern sense. They were beginning to build cities. And again, throughout this time, Spanish had never stopped being spoken. So in the example of the Pueblos, who compromised 19 different tribes, the Pueblo Nation, their languages became, their dialects became unintelligible. They couldn't no longer speak to each other in their own dialects. So the lingua franca for the Pueblo is Spanish, Right. When they gathered intertribally, the language that the elders are speaking in is like this kind of old, broken up Spanish that they learned from the missionaries. And this is the true with the Maricopas, the Pimas, the Zunis. They all speak Spanish.
And a lot of them were Catholic.
And a lot of them were Catholic. Again, this was something that was stunted, sadly, by the Mexican government when they secularized the missions.
It sounds like these tribes were really just one or two generations away from being fully Hispanicized.
Yes, they were in the midst of Hispanization. It's a very sad, overlooked chapter of history. And again, it's all conveniently brushed under the rug, under the Spanish genocide rug, right? It's like there's no subtlety when they analyze what they're saying. There's no actual historical investigation. It's just... Again, because what happens? Well, once these people got conquered by the Anglos, now their kids are in Anglo-American school. And so now when you don't have a written language like these people didn't have, or their languages were just beginning to be written down thanks to the Spanish, it's very easy to uproot a culture's history. And that's essentially what the Anglos did, right? Now remember, a lot of these Indians actually have Spanish names, right? They've adopted Spanish names. Now, they may have lost the Catholic customs and traditions, sadly, but they kept those names. And so now it's like you see that induced schizophrenia of like, well, your problem started with the people whose name you carry. And I think you actually saw this in the Philippines as well, which I'm not an expert on, but I've heard pretty much this exact same thing happen in the Philippines. I wish Ed was here because he knows a lot about that history.
The Philippines is, that's another story. They're really, really, if you think Mexicans are a neurotic idea of their past, the Philippines are that, but worse.
Yeah. But you saw essentially the same program of how we're going to de-Hispanicize these people. And that's really the program, both with the Indians of the Southwest and what they're seeking to do with us now. Let me.
No. In yep. Philippines, it was worse because the U.S. destroyed cathedrals, missions. They did what they couldn't do in Puerto Rico.
Yeah, it's true. Well, they did that in California too. So much, all the communal land that the Indians held and that the Spanish crown recognized was stolen from them. And the same thing happened with the mestizos and the mulattos of California, who some of them were very prominent and wealthy, and all their wealth was completely confiscated, which went against the treaty that they had signed when they brokered a peace. The peace was stipulated that their wealth and their property would be recognized, and sadly, it wasn't. Let me continue on, because I'm almost done with this lecture from Maria Elvira. Sadly, again, all the Indians today have been re-educated to blame the Spanish, not the Anglos. The gold rush displaces Indians from the lands that were recognized during the empire. And now with the growing Hispano population in the U.S., the question is how do you deal with these people, right? And, you know, it comes back to alchemy, to shaming people of their heritage. But what has to be understood is that el español de California no solo tragó la tierra, right? Like, what happened to the Spaniards of New Mexico, Texas, and California? They just weren't swallowed up. Now, I've seen people sometimes bring up, like, some of these people claim they're Spanish but not Mexican. But it has to be understood that the Southwest was not a colony of Spain. It was a colony of New Spain, right? New Spain expanded into the Southwest, and the people who manned and who fought that expansion were essentially Novo Hispanos, were the proto-Mexicans, right? They're the ones who conquered this, including, what was the name of the statue that they tore down in New Mexico? I forget the guy's name.
Juan de Oñate.
Right. Juan de Oñate is a perfect example of that.
That's a heritage for Mexicans, because if Mexicans claim Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz, why they don't claim Juan de Oñate, right?
Precisely, yeah. And again, some of this lies, of course, in our fault. Like, we cannot blame the Anglos, because before Latin American studies, we had already committed like the original sin, and we're going to expand on that. But let me keep continue here. So all the governors that took over this this Southwest, they stole the lands, right? Leland Stanford basically stole Palo Alto, where the first statue of Junipero Serra was torn down, by the way. It was in Palo Alto. So interesting how Leland Stanford, you know, from the university, he stole the land. They put up a statue of Serra, and it's the first one that gets taken down. It must be remembered that the Californios were overwhelmingly mestizo, Indios, and mulatos. They were not white Spaniards. Very few white Spaniards came this far. This area was settled by mestizos, mulatos, and Indios from all over the empire. So sadly, you know, a lot of so when people kind of bring up the conflict of like these people from New Mexico will reject the Mexican identity, in a way, I think it's kind of fair because, again, when did we become Mexican, right? It's like, well, I thought we were all subjects of the crown and we were all Españoles, right? Las Españas. And then all of a sudden we get, you know, a horse rider comes up with a letter saying, oh, we're no longer part of the Spanish crown. We're now part of the Mexican Empire. And then, like, you know, the next day shows up another horse rider and says, oh, no, we're not part of the Mexican Empire. We're part of the Mexican Republic. You know what I'm saying? So it's like these people had no ability to become Mexican. So in a way, it was like they were abandoned by Spain and Mexico following it, and they were largely ignored by the U.S., but these communities never died out, right? And neither did the use of the Spanish language. And I'm talking both for the mestizos of the Southwest, but also these Indian nations that I listed up earlier. So again, I want to tie this now into what we covered in the Huntington episode, and realizing that from a Huntingtonian perspective, and I think from somebody like this guy who started the Indigenism, political Indigenism, John Collette from the Bureau of Indian Affairs, was that they understood who was the biggest threat to the Anglos in the U.S. And they realized that if they don't control this minority, if this minority isn't, this group isn't ignorant of itself, then they pose a huge, huge threat. And so now what you're seeing is that it's kind of like this iconoclasm of everything that's anti-Spanish, especially here in the United States. Everything that's Spanish is being smashed and broken. You're seeing it literally with the statues, but even within ourselves, right? You see it with these kind of people who identify as indigenous, even though they have, you know, hazel eyes and olive skin. Because what you want to do is you want to destroy this ever growing group of people's history and their foundational myths so that they don't feel strong and rooted and abandon their culture so that they can be absorbed by what I call jam culture, right? So the goal is we want to absorb these people. In order to do it, we need to create some kind of internalized schizophrenia. We need to take away their foundational myths so that they don't feel strong and rooted, and so that they have no choice but to abandon that identity. But the issues that they're having is that it's hard for them because we're so close to home, right? We can go back and feed ourselves culturally, you know, when we go to our countries or in places like Miami, it's almost you don't need to go back because you essentially already are. But this destruction of our heritage will not stop. You know, it's only going to get worse. So that's pretty much the bulk of this lady's lecture. And now I'd like to open it up. I think, if you guys want to respond to that, and then Taco, if you want to share with us some of those points, please do.
Yeah, so I have some points here that we need to take into consideration because this is really going to dispel a lot of this myth of the Black legend that Spain was a predatory or depredador empire. And so the first one is the Law of Burgos, which is in 1512. And that's literally 20 years after the first arrival. So you can imagine, right, a war happening between two different worlds, two different cultures. And within 20 years, the Spanish crown, Isabel la Católica, is already proposing laws to establish the legal nature of the Indio as a free man, you know, including property rights and the fact that he could not be exploited. They had to actually pay him working hours were established. Minors were exempted from working.
This is, by the way, this is where the 8-hour workday comes from. The first reference of an 8-hour workday comes from the Spanish Empire saying that the Indians cannot be forced to work more than 8 hours a day. By the way.
Right. And the Indian chieftains and their descendants are to be respected. There's actually a house of Montezuma, a royal house that lives in Spain. And for the longest time, Mexico, I believe, was getting payments to this house. You know, this is basically never before have these situations happened like this. So the right of conquest was something that was accepted universally throughout all of mankind for, you know, ever since the beginning of human societies. And it was in this context, in the Spanish context, it was based on three sources, which was Roman law, medieval law, and pontifical law, right? And Spain complied with all three. But then Carlos I stopped the actual conquest to determine whether or not it was legitimate from a moral point of view.
That's right. This is the first time in history when an empire stops conquering. It says, pause. Let's look at the conquest we've done so far. It's under Charles V, or Carlos I or the V, depending what crown you're looking at him from. And he said, let's basically analyze. Let's do some introspection here. Let's see if what we've done is righteous in the eyes of God. And if we should continue or if we should stop. Something like this has never happened in human history.
And it's important. It's important to highlight that the Spaniards juridically, politically, and spiritually and saw the monarchy of Moctezuma and the monarchy of Atahualpa in Peru as a continuation of their monarchy, you know?
That's right.
So that's why you see a statues of Moctezuma and of Atahualpa in the palaces of the Bourbons in Spain.
Right. So I have three more points, right? So like, Rancho, this is what you said, where it's the first time that they have this introspection, and that's where you get the Valladolid debates.
Debates, yep.
And then when they're questioned, and this is where you have the protector de los indios come in, and basically the modern notion of human rights is now born. So never before had a victorious people wondered where their own rights began and where those of the defeated party began. This is brand new. No one really asked themselves this at the time in previous, all of, you know, the thousand something, 2,000 years of history, people just slaughtered everybody, man, woman, child, scorched earth.
Indiscriminately.
You know, and indiscriminate. And then, you know, they would take maybe what the prettiest woman for the men. So this is the first time that political power is submitting to moral philosophy and theology. And this is the theologians of the school of Salamanca who carry out this task. And this is the first concept you see establishing from international law and human rights.
Right.
And I think, that was it for my main points. So it just shows that you see a progressive crown, but not in today's progressive sense, but one in which they're looking at these conquered people, you know, as their own subjects. And this term subjects has a negative connotation with our, you know, democratic republic understanding of what the word subject means. But subject is really only just subject to the authority. The crown was the authority, but all Spaniards were subject to the crown's authority. And then this authority was derived from God. The crown itself was subject to the authority of God, which is why they even stopped to introspect and to see. And obviously there were abuses because people are flawed. and, you know, they're thousands of miles away across an ocean, and
right,
you know, communication is not instant.
They weren't controlling the conquistadors by a dog collar. The generals of these armies were pretty much left to their own devices, and every time that they committed wrong, they were punished for it. Many of them even being executed for it. You know, for example, Columbus, it's funny because I stumbled across this woman. What's her name? Excellent Mexican Torta. She said,
Chicken Export.
Mexican
La Tortita.
Excellent Torta de Mexico. So she says, she cites five books that kind of made her woke to her Mexica identity or whatever. And notice that this woman is definitely more Spanish than she is indigenous. I think she and I think she tries to Indian wash herself by, she's a little bit on the thick side, which kind of makes the eye folds look a little bit more Asianish.
I'd say she's more donut than anything.
She's more what?
More donut.
Yeah, the donuts make your eyes look a little bit more chinky-eyed, if you will. I don't know if that's a politically correct statement. I don't really give a fuck. Anyways, but it definitely makes her look a little bit more Indian than she actually is. But this girl is pretty much just an average girl from Jalisco. And Jalisco is pretty much the whitest state in Mexico.
It's up there.
Yeah, I would say it is. But one of the books that she cites is Letters from America, which is about basically Columbus's first, you know, encounters on his first voyage. And, you know, the pattern that Columbus set up was not the pattern that was taken in the conquest. What he did in the islands was not what was done. And Columbus himself was stripped of all his wealth at the end of the day, I think. And I think he died in prison, or his sons died in prison. It's something I have to look into. I don't know if any of you guys know the details of Columbus's end.
No, but, you know, what this does is it really, you know, shows that the Spanish crown was not interested in systematic, right? When you have a word like systematic, like extermination or exploitation of the indigenous people. That, yeah,
that's a very Germanic, Anglo-Germanic view. And again, what my theory is that this is actually rooted largely in theology, though not exclusively. I think even before Christianity, these people's kind of tribal outlook influenced a lot of it, whereas our outlook isn't so tribal. Our outlook is informed by the Roman Empire, which the Spanish Empire was like a second wave or third or fourth wave of that same empire. I think what needs to be noted here too is this whole concept. Yeah, like she said, there was nothing systemic, there was nothing racist about it, because, you know, there's plenty of beautiful paintings of Indian nobles who were part of the Order of Santiago, who had that. I mean, they were the elite of the Spanish elite, right? They were knighted. They had, you know, Spanish pages and essentially servants and slaves who were Spanish. And just because you were, you know, some Spaniard peasant who, you know, managed to save up enough money to get across the ocean to come here, you didn't have more rights or privileges than, you know, an Indian of high caste or high class. And then it has to be understood that when they try to portray the Spanish as these racist people, is that it's impossible to make the claim of racism if there is mestizaje, right? Mestizaje implicitly destroys racism, because it's saying that though you're different from me, we aren't that different enough where we can't marry and procreate, right? There's no view of you're a different species or a subspecies of what I'm a better version of. Which enters into conflict here, because, and you can really see this with the Afrocentrists, where they say, well, you know, the blacks have always been discriminated against, and they're never accepted, right? Like, we're not accepted, we're discriminated against, they keep us out. But how can you be kept out if we're mixing with you? And then what you see is the counter argument, where it's like, oh yeah, the reason why there isn't that many Afro-Mexicans is because they were all mixed out. But I thought you were crying about not being included and accepted. You see how this thing is like self-contradictory? So it's like, it's either one or the other. Either you want to be discriminated against and basically forced into a ghetto and you can't mix with people, or you mix with people and you form something new, which is what we are, right? That's what I...
They hate mestizaje.
Yeah, and I want to expand on that.
Yeah, just real quick. If anything, you read the history of the Spanish Empire, they were the original anti-racist. They fought racist powers like England and Holland, and they were protecting the natives from other Europeans. I mean, Blas de Lezo's wife was Peruvian Inca, and he beat off the British. Can you imagine the genocide that would have happened to all the Indians and mixed race people if South America had fallen to the British? So if anything, the Spanish were against racism. They were the original anti-racists.
Absolutely. I mean, they promoted the use of the, you know, when they talk about Spanish is a colonizer language, the Spanish wrote dictionaries and grammars of all the Indian languages they encountered. They gave the Indians who didn't have written language a written language. And if you go to a place like Paraguay, you see them still speaking Guarani because of the way that the Spanish dealt with the other. I think the case can be made, and very fairly so, that the most humane empire in history was the Spanish Empire. I don't think there's a more humane example of it.
I mean, the Jesuits in Paraguay, they created republics of natives. They teach them Spanish, you know what I mean?
And they had representation.
No, yeah, exactly. And they put the Jesuits armed the Guaranis to fight against the Brazilian colonies that were the most... If you compare the Brazilian treatment to their native population to the Spanish treatment of their native population, the Spanish were way more human. The Brazilians were brutal towards their natives. They used to play... The Brazilians used to play, like, let me hunt the native. They were brutal.
And this actually, since we're on the subject real quick of Portugal, I want to talk a little bit about the slave trade. I always hear this a lot. They say that Latin America imported more slaves. And here you see the alchemy behind the Latin definition, because now all of a sudden, Brazil is part of Hispanoamerica. But if you look at the actual slaves to Hispanoamerica, for a land mass that was way bigger than the 13 colonies of the United States, it brought in 700,000 Indians, according to this black academic, I forget her name. They brought in 700,000, while the Americans, the Anglos, brought in 500,000 into the 13 colonies, but they brought in 4.5 million into the West Indies. So the Anglos brought in 5 million. The Hispanics brought in less than 1 million total African slaves. And the Portuguese brought in 5 million as well.
I think it's important to highlight that the monarchy of the Habsburgs was not exactly a very like pro-slavery type of monarchy. They didn't control the slave commerce. And it was the Bourbons who truly began to participate in that.
Yeah, yeah, and again, we'll save that episode of the Empire and the different dynasties and the characters they took. We'll save that for another episode. But that is important to note, and I just want to kind of nip at the bud this whole notion of more slaves went into Latin America. Well, now you're clumping Brazil and the Portuguese crown was for a big chunk, unfortunately, when it wasn't under Spain, it was an ally of the Anglos. But I want to expand on again this racism. How you see that? And it's important to note actually that the Bourbons were French, right? They were brought in by French influence. The French installed the Bourbon dynasty into Spain, and I think it had, you know, we'll debate those consequences for another episode. But again, you don't see. I'm not saying that racism doesn't exist in Hispanoamerica, but you have to understand the degrees of it, where, again, you're not really being discriminated or kept out if you're being offered to mix with people, right? There's an implicit equality when I marry you and decide to have children with you. And you compare this to somebody like Jefferson, right, who had mulatto kids and never recognized them, right? They never had his last name. So in a sense, they were never his sons. So how were these children made? They had no father. Whereas the Spanish always recognized the children that they had with their black slaves and tended to free their slaves upon their death, upon the Spaniard's death. Cortez did have, you know, sons with Indians, but he did recognize that they were his sons.
Yeah, it probably has to do quite a bit with religion.
It totally has to do with it.
Whereas the Anglos were already Judaizers of sorts, Jefferson probably saw them as shiksas, if you will, you know, for lack of a better word.
Yes.
And not having the dignity
they were going
of a human being, like you had mentioned in the past, to be his wife, you know.
And I think religion really informs this, but it also has to be understood even before the Christian religion. The Romans already had a tradition of this, right? From the foundation, one of the foundational myths of Rome is the raping of the Sabine, right? The Romans came from Troy, and they landed in the Italian peninsula, and they didn't have enough women, so they basically stole the women from their neighbors. So Rome was born with a mixture of women from another race. And the way that the Roman Empire developed was essentially the same way was the roots of how the Spanish Empire developed. So before Christianity, there was already a tendency, there was already a civilizational outlook which operated along the same lines.
And then I guess you could highlight how we're the real Romans.
Yes, that's something that I include when I mention our three roots. The first root is Cristo Rey, right? Logos incarnate. The second root is our Spanish heritage, our language. But it's also the Roman legacy, because Spain, the Spanish, in a sense, are a product of a Romanized mestizaje, both from the pre-Christian and the post-Christian Romans. It's what, in a sense, the Romans for the Spanish play the role that the Spanish play for us Hispanoamericanos, if that makes sense.
It does. It makes perfect sense.
Trajan was our great-grandfather.
Exactly. And here's the thing, that when these people are pushing you in a position to where this, in this period of iconoclasm, everything that's Spanish, you are disconnecting yourself from Trajan. Right? Now, what we're offering and positioning is that you embrace your Spanish heritage just as much as you embrace el mestizaje. And the mestizaje shouldn't be overlooked. It's one of the three roots. Without the third root, the thing doesn't work. The mestizaje is a nice thing because it allows us to have that diversity amongst ourselves, right? Because the mestizaje of the Mexican Central Valley is different from the mestizaje of Peru, the Peruvian and the Mexican get to take a different form, right? There's a different essence to Peru as there is in Mexico. Yet at the same time, it is our Spanish blood, our Spanish heritage, our second root that connects us all, regardless of the mestizaje of, for example, the Dominican Republic, which again involved much more of an African admixture than that of Argentina, which involved basically European women as the admixture. But these people, they want to disable you. And this is really, really it comes down to. It has to be understood that we're talking again of 600 to 700 million people at childbearing age, right? Where basically this generation has the opportunity to set the path of this continent into a completely different direction that people like Huntington, that people behind these books that Mexican Excellent Torta likes to cite, which I want to go through those authors, we have the power to direct history in a completely different direction. You know, when you look at Spanish speakers being 16% of world GDP, which is actually more than the United States. I think the United States is about 15%. You know, there's a bigger economy at play here. There's a bigger population at play here. There's a deeper heritage and legacy to carry on from both sides. You know, this is one of the reasons why my first handle on Twitter was Romanus Mesoamericanus, because I am absorbing these heritage. I am saying that, you know, my ancestors you know, were these amazing mathematicians and astrologers and engineers who built these cities and lakes and pyramids that were lined up with the stars. And at the same time, I'm also proudly claiming descent from the people who, you know, had one of the most amazing empires in history, the Roman Empire itself. And why
you're the summation of all your ancestors.
Exactly. All of them. And why should I be deprived of that? Why are our enemies seeking to induce us with this internalized schizophrenia, this bipolarity, to reject our Spanish heritage and in that lose the legacy that even Spain itself is a product of? Spain doesn't own the Roman legacy. The Roman legacy is what created Spain.
Yeah. Well, so it's definitely a weakening agent.
Well, that's what it comes down to.
Notice how these pro-indigenous groups, they hate the idea of the mestizo. They hate race mixing. They hate mestizaje.
They're the real racists.
Because they recognize that that's the way we unite ourselves with each other and with Spain and with other people from other republics as well, or from other nations, or from other Hispanics.
How do they try to incorporate that? In other words, like the Indios are not supposed to marry the more Spanish?
No, they Mexican, actually,
for example, or something like that.
They don't go full blown white Nazi. They go just like, you know, they just want to include mestizos into the native identity.
Yeah.
But this is silly because. And they always argue that why race, you know, you can be mestizo and indigenous and so on, and that blood quantum do not matters, you know. But I always want to highlight that for natives, blood quantum did matter, especially for those natives wanted to maintain the pre-Columbian order. The best example of this is the Peruvian, the Inca historian, Huamán Poma, from the 16th century, I think. He was from the Inca nobility, but he sort of lost his privileges during the Spanish crown, right? But he still had a position of power. He still knew Quechua, he knew a lot of languages, he knew Spanish. And he wrote an amazing book to Philip III to promote the idea that they should be two republics separated from each other.
So the Jim Incan Crow,
Republic,
he wanted,
Native
he
wanted, Republic and the Spanish Republic under the head of the Spanish king and the Catholic religion. But he viewed the mestizo as this agent of destruction of the order, which makes sense in the sense that it was from the perspective of an Incan of a pure Indian noble. You know what I mean? Oh, so. Yeah. Instead of being against racial race mixing, they're against cultural race mixing. You know what I mean?
I do. Yeah.
That's the ones today.
So the mestizo for them, it's just the same argument. They just don't like race mixing because that's.
But here's what these people don't understand, that if we took away our second root. You know, to go back to the scheme of the three roots, right? Cristo Rey, Spanish paternal heritage, in a sense, and the mestizaje, which is kind of the maternal, right? If you took away the Spanish paternal root from our identity, it automatically takes away the first one. And that's really what they're positioning. And what they're positioning or what they're promoting is matriarchy. And you caught this with... Paola, the teacher from New York. You catch this with Mexican torta girl. You catch glimpse of this with all these detractors of basically the Spanish were evil. The Spanish language is a colonizer language, and Christianity is a religion of the conquerors. And so
it's mostly women.
It's mostly women and homosexuals. And
their morality to take over God's morality. That's basically what it
that's
is.
That's really just, what they're
they
rejecting.
They
want
to do the virtual signal. That's all it is.
Yeah, that's really what they're rejecting. The Spanish, again, just serve as a... ¿cómo era?
Chivo expiatorio.
Chivo expiatorio, right? The Spanish serve as...
Scapegoat.
As the scapegoat, as the sacrificial lamb, where we can wash away all our sins by basically pinning everything bad on the Spanish. And now we can kind of just be... It'll just be us. It'll be, you know... Basically, my mom had me, and again, you always see the patterns of daddy issues, single family homes with these people. I think you will always find it with these people, and I don't think there's a coincidence of it. So, when they're rejecting our Spanish heritage, they're not just rejecting the Spanish heritage; they're rejecting the religion, they're rejecting their father, they're rejecting the concept of a father, of a male head of a family. And that's really what it's about, which is why it's so these movements are simpatico with movements like BLM, which are formed by Black lesbian women who take a position that's very much the same. It's just the dismantling of order, and it's the imposition of matriarchal chaos is really, if we wash away all the ethnic labels from this, it really comes down to that spiritually. And there's no surprise.
You end up with bitch asses like Radical Latino, you know, who has daddy issues and always playing the victim card. I have no respect for that motherfucker. Fuck him.
Yeah.
Oh, he bit me. Fuck that motherfucker.
But you see the same. You see the same pattern. So let me actually read an Instagram post by a bearded man who LARPs like a woman, two-spirit type of guy, whatever the fuck that means. His name is Indigenous Pride. He says this: although the mestizo is indicted by the decolonial thinker as, and this is what it comes all about, decolonialism, whatever. Okay. Although the mestizo is indicted by the decolonial thinker as completely opposite of the Indian, and therefore to identify as mestizo in either blood or culture is to reject one's indigeneity. If we conceptualize ourselves as colonized people on a spectrum of settler colonial oppressions and influences...
This is so great. This is so great, dude. Look, I'm sorry for interrupting you here, but they just want to make... They're just like probably like one-fourth native or some mestizo wanting to be a victim. That's basically it.
Yeah, and again, you always see the same patterns of daddy issues and of rejection of the church. And this guy, by the way, he's tan, but his face does not look Indian. He has a full beard, which Indians don't grow full beards. I can't grow a full beard. He has a full beard. This guy looks like Balboa, the conqueror Balboa, the conquistador Balboa, just more red-skinned than olive-toned. But let me continue. If we conceptualize ourselves as a colonized people on a spectrum of settler colonial oppressions and influences, mestizaje is just another area from which indigeneity can spring from. Mestizaje is centered on European identity. Mestizos overwhelmingly choose to speak, practice the religion, and adhere to the customs of their Spanish ancestry. What if we could recenter indigeneity in mestizaje? If we normalize the idea that each and every one of us have differing goals and interests in where our decolonial journeys go and where they end, perhaps the mestizo can be reconciled with the Indian. The problem is mestizaje is very much rooted in harmful European axiological, epistemological, and ontological assumptions. The mestizo has embraced the idea, be it out of hatred, ignorance, or survival mechanism, to deny their indigeneity. Indigenous denialism is prevalent in mestizo identities all across the Americas. I completely disagree with that. Even traditional native people are colonized in the base reality of living within or in the proximity of settler colonial nation states. Culturally, we all share in the experience of a living world, a reality, a society, and a culture not of our choosing, nor the product of our many nations' sovereignty and self-direction. Under the toxic yoke of colonized living and thinking, indigenizing our ancestry offers each and every one of us various ways to escape the entrapments of our beliefs, our imposed identities, and the dominant culture around us. Each of us can explore that in ways that are meaningful to us, yet still support one another as a great Indigenous American collective that operates on unity, so that we may achieve our collective sovereignty and that we may correct the course of history and of this earth. Let me show you real quick what this guy looks like. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think for me, this just seems more attacks against His Majesty, you know, because it's not even really about the Indian blood, the Indian traditions. You see how they were trying to snake in there about, you know, the European religion and whatnot. So, yeah, I mean, it just all connects to what you were saying earlier about the patriarchy and God the Father. So ultimately, it is another sledgehammer against the church via Hispanismo, so to speak.
Yeah,
because it's an agent of the church, if you will.
It's a rejection of masculinity, and I mean, this isn't an exaggeration. Check out that link I just shared with you guys, and obviously I'll put the image up on the video. But look at this,
in many ways,
look at this guy's face. Think of it
about a little like this, like, oh, you know, like, okay, maybe you're not ready to do the LGBT thing. Yeah. Well, hey, look, we got this little Indio group, you know, that you could maybe you want to do that. And it's, you know, it's like a little mild dose of the same thing going on.
Right. And it reminds me of what I had said before we started the show, where it's like, it's real funny that a lot of these Indigenous type of people just don't even look Indigenous. They don't even look mestizo. They look more on the Spanish side. And again, that you can't always just discriminate by color. You have to look at people's facial features. And this guy definitely has more a Spanish profile. He looks a lot like Balboa. He even has kind of like the sleepy Mediterranean Arabic eyes as compared to, you know, I think this guy's actually from Peru, an Andean type of phenotype. But what I had said earlier was that it doesn't matter if you're not, you know, pure Indian, you know, even if you're just 10-20% Indian and you're 80% Spanish, what you have in so-called whiteness, you can undo by being homosexual. So the more the gayer you are at the it's a sub in for what you lack in Indian. Right. So it's like you're only 10% Indian, but you're 80% gay. So you're all Indian. You get an Indian pass.
You're all in.
But you see how even in homosexuality, then again, you are automatically taking a position that's completely against the first root. Right. It's completely against nature and logos. Right. We're saying logos.
Wait. Rancho, look what I found.
Yeah.
There's a post of him with a. Him talking with the ghost of an Inca Garcilaso.
Yeah. I'm about to read it. I already had it.
Bro. and to say, El Inca Garcilaso de la Vega was a very proud mestizo.
Yes.
He embraced both roots. And I suppose this guy must hate him because of that.
Yes. Inca Garcilaso was a very interesting man. He was
the first spiritual mestizo of the Americas.
Yes. He's the first mestizo, man. So let me read this post that he made about Inca Garcilaso. So I'm speaking with the ghost of El Inca Garcilaso de la Vega, and he's trying to explain to me that it isn't that he hates the Indians. He tells me that his first language was Quechua and that he wore his Inti necklace all the days of his natural life. But it's also that he loves his Spanish side. And I'm listening to him because he's crying and he's telling me that his father left him when he was young. And I'm crying because my father left me when I was young. El Inca tells me that loving Spain made him feel closer to his father, the conquistador Garcilaso de la Vega. And I'm telling him that loving Chinchat Usuyu makes me feel closer to mine. El Inca Garcilaso tells me that it required extraordinary acts to destroy our world, and that it will require extraordinary acts to revive it. He tells me of a secret prophecy of our ancestors. He tells me of the two meteorites that hit the earth, which foretold the deaths of Huayna Capac and of Atahualpa Yupanqui. And then the ghost disappeared. Gay.
Super gay.
You saw the father side, the father question here.
Yes, you did. You see?
No, these
parody.
These people are
No, it's not a parody.
The thing is, like, not even natives don't like to claim mestizos. The natives usually see mestizos as enemies, and it's going to be like that. It's going to be like that when mestizos realize that they don't need to LARP as fucking natives, you know? Because actual natives, one of the worst things for natives has been this appropriation by mestizos of nativeness. Yeah, it's true. Mestizos should have the right to feel connected with the native side, but they shouldn't appropriate and say something like, we are natives. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it seems to me very much like the natives are not actually the problem. It's like this LARPy modern group of...
It's coming from outside.
Mestizo, you know, like some, you know, it's not really them.
Yeah, it's coming from outside.
Yeah, and quit.
Yeah.
Their native, their native identity, their spirituality comes from a new age kind of indigenous spirituality. So like he's like talking to the guy's ghost, like to some kind of seance. Like it sounds very new agey.
This nigga.
He ain't about to rip a heart out of somebody's chest cavity, let's just say.
No.
He's going to light some incense and read some tarot cards.
It's a LARP.
What were you saying, Alex?
Yeah, it's a LARP, you know.
Hold on. Let me hear from Alex. We're kind of all talking the same. Alex, what are you saying?
The best in New York, in New York, and Inquisitor knows what I'm talking about because we mentioned it offline. In New York, you got a lot of Puerto Ricans that are like straight up white. I mean, they look Castilian or Italian. I'm Taino.
Yeah. That's true.
That's like a big thing.
It is true. But I think there's a couple different ways of doing it. I mean, you could like meme it. It's just mildly and kind of like, you know, Taino. Everybody's like, aha, and that's it. You know, it's not like an identity that you rebel with or that you say that you're oppressed or anything like that.
Well, some do.
You know what I mean? It's like a mild thing at times, at least.
But the ones that do will tend, some do, and they tend to be feminist and they tend to be homosexual. So it means to me that they have some kind of fatherhood trauma, some male either broke their heart in high school or molested them as a little kid. And so that's why they express their homosexuality and their feminism. They have a gripe against men, and it usually centers around the father. I think this might sound a little funny, but I'm honestly being sincere. You'll always see this pattern, and there's a reason. So whenever I encounter these people, like, my policy from now on is just to ask them, how old were you when you were first molested? And was it your cousin, your uncle, your neighbor? Who was it? Like, let's just get to it, because clearly that's what happened to you. And so...
But besides...
Yeah.
But besides the psychologization of the problem, I think this is... It's just destructive for us, for the unity of ourselves, for everything.
And that's the goal.
Destructive for us.
That's the goal. The goal is to neutralize this generation from feeling strong in their roots so that they don't activate and start basically calling the shots, which their sheer numbers allow them to do. And the fact that we are mestizo, again, it doesn't mean that we should LARP like Indians, right? Or LARP like full-blooded Spaniards either. It's about embracing both roots and being able to serve as a bridge, in a sense, for this world. But at the same time, realize that in the fusion of this mestizaje, we became something else. And there's nothing wrong with that. And it's that something else is infinitely stronger if you accept who you are and embrace this gigantic legacy that comes with it, right? That predates even Spain itself.
And yeah. if you eliminate, like, the idea of pan-indigenous, like a pan-indigenous identities are based in fakeness. It's not a true thing.
It can't function. It's stupid.
Yeah, what I mainly do is I basically say I'm Spanish, made with Taino and African parts, you know? but I speak Spanish. I'm Catholic.
In New York, they call Hispanics Spanish, right? That's just what they call you guys.
Yes. Hispanic and Spanish is synonymous here.
Right.
Spanish is not a direct reference to the peninsula. It pretty much means Hispano across the board.
You know, these guys just want to, they just are like immigrants and they just want to get benefits from being an indigenous or some bullshit like that.
I think that's part of it. I have a big example.
This Puerto Rican boxer, Hector Macho Camacho.
Macho time.
He actually got adopted into the Seminole tribe of Florida on the grounds that he was a Taino.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my. Now he,
I'm serious.
He has to, does he own a casino now or what?
He died in Puerto Rico.
He was
buying a bag and got shot.
He always used to LARP heavy though in the ring where he used to wear like la pluma así como with like the cacique headgear and all that. He used to enter the ring with all that. But you know, this is like a prior wave, I think, of this. Because he did that. All right, he might have joined the Seminole thing, but like that was it. It's not nothing. It didn't carry any steam. There was no political implications. It was just like, all right, you left Taino a little bit cool. Now you know, whatever.
It wasn't anti-mestizo, right? It was him just simply embracing his Indian roots. And I think speaking about the Seminoles is really interesting because. You know, the history of Florida, essentially the Spanish allowed African slaves from the United States to come into Florida. And if they adopted Catholicism, well, they were basically given weapons and cities to form. This is what Formosa is about.
Good point. But listen, not only was it not anti-mestizo, it was not even anti-Spanish, right. Nor anti-God. Porque, you know, he still used to cross himself. Yeah. Y le rezaba Papito Dios en la pelea and all that.
Right.
So it wasn't
weaponized. Was a Boricua.
Yeah, exactamente. He used to LARP as a Taino, you know, to have fun, rep part of his heritage, and that's it. It wasn't to subvert or overthrow or undermine anything. But that's
he was just flamboyant. It was an act, you know, boxing, to kind of like wrestling, you know, just playing a character.
Right.
And he probably wanted some casino money. Let's be real.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, great. Exactly. You know, it's not the monster that we're facing now that it's, destructive.
You know what's funny? The funny thing is when you ask U.S. Native Americans, like the few that exist about them, they don't. Them, it's sort of like a picture, like a sort of like a funny image, you know, to see these mestizos LARPing as Indians and wanted to be like them.
Well,
they often clash, you know.
I don't know if they do. Like here in the Southwest, it's hard to distinguish the Native Americans from the Mexicans because they'll tend to have Spanish last names. I think one of the ways to tell is essentially how they live. Unfortunately, the Indians here have been incredibly marginalized by the Anglos, and they live very poor lives. Even if they get government money every month, it actually only compounds their poverty. It creates like a weird system of dependence. But it's hard to distinguish because the Indians here also aren't like pure-blooded Indians. And here you in the United States, you see like pure white Indians, like the Indians of the Northeast and like those nations, they don't even look Indian anymore at all. They just look white. And yet you'll see like these people with like Choctaw Nation license plates frames around their cars. And then it's like a green-eyed blonde hair lady coming out of her car with a Louis Vuitton bag. But, you know, she's managed to work the system and somehow claim that she's a Choctaw Indian. And so she benefits from that.
Should I have a little piece of jewelry, like something.
Yeah, some piece of turquoise, and now she's a Choctaw. Where now compare that to the Indians in Mexico and especially Guatemala or Bolivia or Paraguay even. I mean, look at Paraguay. I think Paraguay is like the most best example of mestizaje, where like Macho Camacho, both roots are being embraced and actually feed into each other, right? They're this false dialectic, and that's kind of what they're doing. They're imposing a false dialectic in the mestizo of either you have to be Indian or you have to be Spaniard. You can't be a fusion of both. And again, I think there's a religious undertone to it. And if you look at the books that she actually references, very interesting. The first book that Mexican Excellent Torta cites is American Holocaust by David E. Stannard. And if you look at David Stannard up on Wikipedia, you realize he's he went to Yale, got an MA from Yale. He also went to Stanford. And he was born in a Jewish household. So I think it has to be understood that the Jews have a historical conflict and animosity with La Hispanidad, right? During the Reconquest, or after the Reconquest, the Jews were basically said, told, as the Muslims, either you convert or you get out. And tons of Jews converted, you know, tons of Sephardic Jews converted and became saints of the church and leaders within the empire themselves. I think they like to portray that, you know, a lot of these people were forced, but no, there was an actual campaign to spiritually engage in debate based on the Talmud and convince them to actually convert. And many of them converted. I would say most of them converted willingly. Though I think there was, you know, some of the crypto stuff going on. But it has to be noted that the Jewish identity has a historical gripe against the Spanish identity, not just because of what happened during the Reconquista, but they themselves view the Spanish as Romans. And so they're still mad about the temple being destroyed in 70 AD. So,
yeah, they're still butthurt over that.
And so
they don't forget.
They don't forget. And I believe that the term they use for Hispanics or mestizos or Latin Americans or whatever, the term they use, I think, is like based on Roman, right? Like they call us Romans.
Amalek or some bullshit, right?
Right.
Yeah.
But besides that, it's not the ordinary Jew, but it's mostly like historians, the Jews that like to study history and so on. They tend to be very, and this is merely like a historical and very academic, in academic sense, they tend to be very anti-Roman, anti-Spain, very pro-Cromwell. It's a historical beef. It's just like when a Jew writes a history book as about Spain,
it's going to be anti-Spanish.
Tends to be similar as an Anglo writing a history book.
Well, this is why I call it jam culture, because again, the white nationalists or whatever, they like to like blame the Jews for everything, and it's like the Jews aren't that powerful. It's only when they fuse with the Anglos and they create this world empire and this cultural outlook, liberalism, and they enforce it on the world where it really becomes something. And so it's like you overlook the Anglo role in jam culture. But there's other writers. So then we look at another book by, this book is called Stolen Continents, 500 Years of Conquest and Resistance of the Americas. And you would think, you know, a Native American wrote that, but no, it was Ronald Wright, a WASP born, not WASP. Even WASP. He's actually English. He was born in London, England, and his nationality is Canadian. So he's like super WASP. Let's keep going here. The other slavery, which I think somebody touched on earlier, Andres Resendez, who comes from, he's kind of like a snobby family in Mexico City, but he got his PhD at the University of Chicago, which is the Rockefeller University, an elite jam family. Then she cites the letters from America, Columbus's letters. Again, they're trying to portray the conquest as what Columbus did. And real quick, I'm going to take advantage of this to search up about how Columbus died. Cause from what I know, all his wealth was confiscated. And then, his son died in prison. Ultimately, they basically came to nothing. And then the last book she cites is Access, Rule, and Occupied Europe by Raphael Lemkin, which I think is, he's a Polish or a Polish Jew. But basically what they're trying to do is frame what happened with El Mestizaje as a Holocaust. Which I think even comes into conflicts with some Jews.
Obey.
But yeah, they want to frame it as it was like a premeditated genocide. And That's laughable, to be honest.
Yeah, here's an action article that I had written a response to on Twitter that maybe I should dig up and repost. But it's written by a pseudo-academic named Curly Tlapawaya, who sounds like an Indian name, but he's actually... This guy looks Spanish as fuck. He doesn't even look Indian at all. If you look up
his real name, is probably like Carlos Martinez.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's funny if you go on his if you search up his name in Instagram, and you look at he's an idiot, and you look at his kids, his daughter looks like a white girl. Like she's literally blonde. Fucking motherfucking idiot, dog.
Hey, I'm back. Can you hear me a little better?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say that they would take great offense to the, you know, the Holocaust comparison, because
yeah, they don't like that.
That was you know, you didn't see the Nazis like say, "Oh, let's race mix with you," right? Like, so that whole aspect of the mestizaje being comparable to the Holocaust, they wouldn't like that. But they use that analogy to try to make their point, and it's interesting that they do that. Did you see that article I linked?
Yeah, I was just talking about that right now. I was just talking about him. How this guy looks more Spanish than you, Taco. I don't know if you've seen.
No, dude, he has YouTube videos where he teaches Nahua, and
that's pretty cool.
I found it very interesting. If I can read one of the quotes from his article in that Medium article.
Yeah, please do.
So he says, Hispano identity is firmly rooted in whiteness, while Chicano identity is an open declaration of indigenous pride. In other words, one identity prioritizes a European worldview, while the other celebrates an indigenous cultural inheritance. While Hispanos may pay lip service to this indigenous ancestry by claiming to be, and he quotes, mestizo, or mixed blood, it always comes from the perspective of whiteness, and almost always as an excuse for their racism against, you know, and he's talking about New Mexico, so New Mexico's indigenous people. And he says, how can I be racist? My great-grandmother was a Pueblo Indian. And it's ridiculous because he's being completely disingenuous, right? So like, on the one hand, he's saying that, you know, mestizos have this perspective of whiteness, and even if you embraced your mestizaje, it's still lip service, and it's in internalized racism, and you're coming from a place of whiteness, so you can't win with these people. Right? Like, they're always going to look for some reason to bitch about something. And then so it's okay to firmly affirm your indigenous identity, but it's not okay to affirm your
European
Spanish identity.
Yeah, right. It's funny.
And I can't help to see it in whenever they say, you know, European or Spanish, I keep hearing and feeling Christian.
Yes,
and then when they're repping at the, you know, whatever tribe he wants to rep for, it's like for the pagan world. So I can't help to like keep making those connections. Like, that's because, you know, white is a negative term. Then what does he mean by white? I think he's really saying Christian.
Yes,
that is the connection.
He says,
people hate God, dude. That's what it comes down to.
Yeah, and you see a picture in his Instagram where he's like, he has a picture of like Satan loves abortions.
Sure does.
Yeah, he just straight up like says it like, yeah, abortion's cool. And it's like a little kid holding a poster saying like, yeah, abortion's cool and Satan loves it. So it's like there is an implicit, you know, post-liberalism or just hyper-liberalism that, again, when I connect the roots, comes from the Elizabeths and the Cromwells and the Henry the Eighths. They're just following the logical conclusions of this worldview. But it's funny that he says, in other words, one identity prioritizes a European worldview as if his worldview isn't just as European. So it's like now what he's doing, he's grouping European worldview into a monolith. But what do you mean? Do you mean Scandinavian, or do you mean Roman, or do you mean Italian? Because those aren't the same worldview. They're on the same continent, but those are not the same worldviews. A Presbyterian Scotsman's worldview is not the same as a Spaniard from Malaga's worldview.
Exactly.
Or a Greek from Athens or from Mount Athos' worldview, or somebody from Moscow's worldview. What the hell is he talking about by European worldview?
And then
he calls it the focus.
Yeah.
Right? The way he says that we put the focus solely on the Spanish or European worldview, right, in his terms. And like that's not even true, because when you embrace all three roots, you embrace all three roots as one. It's a trinity for a reason. You can't have one without the other.
Yes,
but they don't want you to embrace the first two. So that's why they only want you to embrace the third, because the third, like you said, is the matriarchy, but also like Alex, I believe, said that like it's that pagan ideology, that pagan spirituality that they also want to embrace, and it's an anti-Christian, anti-God, anti-logos ideology.
Yes, precisely. It comes down to
Quetzalcoatl.
It comes
down to smash the that's right button right now.
It comes down to matriarchy and just the introduction of chaos, you know. And I'm sorry, dude, but that comes from fucking what's the Anglo-Satanist name? The OTO guy?
Crowley.
Crowley. How the fuck Crowley. how is this guy's this indigenex? This Spaniard LARPing is an indigenex worldview, less European. And it's funny, then they will say something like, oh, the Spanish didn't get their civilization. They got it from the Middle East. And it's like, yeah, that makes sense. So then why is it European then? If Christianity is from the Near East, right? So why are you calling it European? And it's funny that they'll lump, again, they'll use whiteness here. But the Spaniards aren't even considered white by the United States government.
Yeah.
So it's we have a conflict of definitions here.
They're liars. That's what it is, man. They're just liars. Their father is, you know, they're liars just like their father. Like that's all. Yeah. That's all it is.
That's right.
It's the white Hispanic race warrior crap.
There it is. Yeah, this guy reminds me a little bit. What's this guy? That guy's name? Talcum X.
Malcolm X.
Yeah, no, Talcum X. He's talking about
Talcum X. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. He's a Mexican version of Talcum
exactly.
X.
Exactly.
Sean King. Sean King.
Who's Talcum X?
Sean King. Do you know who Talcum Sean King X. is? But it's funny. It's funny that in this article he also recognizes things like basically. You know, the Hispanos who never left New Mexico after the Anglo conquest were basically like marginalized. He says something like Spanish American took root in New Mexico only because of the territory's unusual balance of power. And he quotes a WASP here. He says the term became embedded in everyday conversation only because it served the interests of both Anglo and Spanish speaking leaders to propagate it, to spread it from newspaper to tourists to party conventions to political meetings of the smallest towns. What made the term so popular is its malleability. In the eyes of Spanish speaking politicians and newspaper editors, Spanish American invoked a proud Spanish colonial past and an elusive American future, a future in which they might still realize the promise of equality amid Anglo intolerance. So he's basically kind of pointing out like the pick me phenomenon where it's like, oh, by saying I'm Spanish, hopefully like you let me be equal. But I think the threat of somebody like Huntington realized that it's like most Hispanos aren't going to look to be equal. They're going to look to impose their worldview.
Notice, I want to highlight to adopt yours. That phenomenon of white supremacy's ideology embracing the Spanish past. It's a minimal thing. It was very specific to New Mexico and maybe Texas. It was a very specific thing. And it was because of the influence of Anglo ideology.
Yeah.
Mainly.
Yeah, you see that. You see that with Cuba too. When people point out, like, "Oh no, blacks were discriminated in Cuba. They had Jim Crow," and I'm like, "That's because the Americans stole Cuba and were basically trying to make it another state, and so they forced into the Cuban law." Yeah,
pretty much. It was very influenced. That segregation was very influenced by Cuba, by the connection that Cuba had with the U.S.
States, exactly.
And so
Curly has another article where he decries the Afrocentrism, like the ones that LARP as Olmecs. Mm. And he has another article, and he basically says that they're culture vultures stealing the indigenous, history and culture.
Oh, wow.
And the accomplishments. Yeah, there's another one. So he goes into it, and like he basically criticizes them for not, citing sources and not being academic. But then when, he has no internal dialogue, he's not self-aware. He's doing the very exact same thing he's criticizing them for. He's doing it here.
So let them eat themselves.
The problem is too.
So Curly, wait. So Curly. So Curly has some balls after all?
Yeah, I mean, well, when it comes to los negros, sí.
Wow.
He wrote it in Medium too. You can find it if you go into his page.
I'm impressed, dude. I didn't know you had a set hanging out from you. Go ahead, Daniel.
But the thing is, they think that by saying that the proudness that New Mexicans, especially northern New Mexicans, feel about the Spanish plus is not necessarily rooted in racism. It's just rooted in the fact that New Mexico is very influenced by Spain, by Spanish culture. But besides that, they're trying to delegitimize feeling proud about the Spanish past,
Yes, totally. That's really what it's all about. And at the same time, rejecting a worldview of logos. And it's funny because the concept of logos predates Jesus, right? Or at least Jesus incarnating. The Greeks came up with that concept, right? Exactly. Even before him. So even the Chinese have a remnant of this through the concept of Tao. So they are saying that there is no Tao, there is no logos, there is no order, there is no hierarchy, there is no purpose. Everything is just flux. It's all relative. So if everything's all flux and all relative, then why are you crying about the Indians becoming extinct? It's just these people are walking contradiction.
I think they're like vegans. Same thing with vegans. There is no morals, but you shouldn't be killing animals because it's bad. It's the same bullshit, dude.
Yeah, yeah. It's all arbitrary. And I'm sure excellent Mexican torta would be vegan if meat wasn't just so good, because you can tell
she's too big to be vegan. she
le gustan las carnitas. Yeah.
She likes that Spanish pork.
The best.
That's where carnitas actually come from. The fact that los Mexicanos, like los conversos, they wanted to prove they were actually converted, so they would cook the carnitas outside.
Yeah, yeah. So there's a tradition of...
That's what we should do with all the weird evangelicals that don't like to drink or smoke,
Yeah.
Yeah.
We need to force them. You need to smoke this cigarette, if you want to be Hispanic. Also,
a big ring gauge. It's like a 60 ring gauge, 7-inch cigar. You got to smoke in it. And what they had wrong in there to prove yourself.
Yeah, the tradition too. There's also a tradition of basically like a village pig, where basically there's like a pig that just roams town for a year, and everybody feeds it. And they still do this in Nicaragua. And then for Christmas, they'll raffle it or something. But basically, the person who wins the pig shares it with the town when they kill it for Christmas feast.
Dude, that's pretty cool. That's cool. Awesome.
Yeah, that's actually a Spanish. They do this a lot in Spain, but they still do it in certain towns in Hispanoamerica. But it comes from that, basically testing who was really down and who wasn't, because the Muslims and the Jews didn't eat pork, so it was a way of testing their conversion.
Ah, pero según ellos también, Oh, he's puro cabrón. They can't drink. You know how it is over here. The Califas, fool.
Yeah, they're still drinking. So yeah, I want to kind of recapture everything we've said. So we've pointed that indigenism, there's a literary indigenism, which is native to Hispanoamerica. There's like this ethnographic indigenism, which we actually haven't expanded on. So maybe why don't we expand a little bit on that chunk, Haniel, which I know you know about a lot. Basically, how let's talk about the native proto-political indigenism of the Republicans.
It was just pretty much a way to legitimize the fact that the independence, pretty much. It's normal if you're separating yourself from Spain, you should sort of create this mythology that justifies the fact that you're not Spaniard. In the first few days of the American independence, the U.S. did that. So it was basically mestizos LARPing as the
criollos
inheritors of. Yeah, it was. Sorry, it was pretty much criollos LARPing as the inheritors of the Aztec past or the Incan past, and it was pretty silly because they thought, and it had a racist connotation, you know, because they were the inheritors of those great empires, while the natives, the real natives that they were living besides them, they thought of them as sort of like a degenerate version of that. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So that continued with the especially with the liberals. Conservatives, not so much, because conservatives were influenced by the Catholic Church, and the Catholic Church condemned racism and eugenics, while liberalism, no, because they were not Catholic. So yeah, that was pretty much it. That was pretty much the pre-indigenism, pretty much, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you see it as like, you know, this elite class, you know, coming up with a way to mobilize the labor for, like, because, you know, you have this now bulk of the population that's either mestizo or indio, and now you've cut yourself off from the crown, and so that the criollo class is a small minority, an oligarchy ruling over these people, and how are you going to get them now to go along with you and work for you?
Right, because there's no more. Right? There's no more king. You've taken away the crown, and in many ways, you've gutted the church in the same act. I think that's part of it. And what you saw as well was that all the land grants all the recognized land that the Indian nations had was immediately removed. Benito Juarez did this in Mexico, right? The Indian jammer Benito Juarez, the proto-Latinxer. He took away the recognition of Indian lands so that now the Mexican state can develop them as they saw fit. So once the republics took over, the preservation of the languages and the culture of the Indians stopped, right?
So that's the real black legend there.
That's exactly
the
right.
Of the republics, no?
A lot of the stuff that the republics did gets blamed on the empire. Which is unfair. And so, yeah, we definitely will be unpacking that. But, you know, to kind of encapsulate everything we said, so there's a literary indigenism. There is like this ethnographic indigenism that kind of these countries took on as projects to kind of give themselves a more historical myth. But ultimately, what we're dealing with today is a political indigenism, which has a political end in sight. And the political end in sight essentially is to fragment Hispano identity and essentially neutralize it from posing a threat to the Anglo establishment. And what these, Mexican torta girl doesn't recognize and these transvestites on the internet don't understand is that they are actually working for the enemy. They are working for our historical enemies to neutralize us as a demographic threat, which we are.
The saddest part about a lot of these groups is that they think they're the cutting edge of revolt, of dissent. And if they only knew they were like the biggest corporate guys at the end of the day, you know?
Yeah, and you can see it with that. I mean, with BLM being essentially a corporate-sponsored revolution. So it's like, you know, these are the type of people who try to make La Malinche look bad, right? Doña Marina look bad. But who is the real traitors? Who's being the traitors right now? It's these people. These are the ones looking to fragment and dissect, balkanize not just the lands and the domains that we still have under our nominal control, but our own spirits and psyches. They want to balkanize them so that we can be, you know, play into the agenda of our historical enemies. And this is the moment where we find ourselves in. And again, the rejection isn't just Spain. It's not just the Catholic Church, but it's this whole concept of patriarchy and masculinity. And this is where I think these people are actually doing us a favor, because the louder they become, the more they're going to alienate Hispanos. And those Hispanos are going to push back and they're going to push into their patriarchy. They're going to push into their sense of masculinity, their machismo. And this is where we come in, because when you understand that our machismo comes from essentially these three roots, this trinity of our identity, how our identity actually enshrines masculinity and the patriarchy and order and all the good things that come from it. It's not a bad word to us, but it is to them. When these guys automatically defend themselves or reject these indigenous people and go into their sense of masculine identity, we come in, we show them how, again, this is enshrined in our roots. And now I think it makes people kind of start to question and say, like, huh, why don't I go to church, right? What is the actual teaching that this church does? Because I don't really know it, right? I think it's actually going to stimulate a lot of curiosity, and it's actually going to it's going to backfire on them. And
they might find themselves at home, saying things to themselves like, wow, that's what abuelita used to say, you know, things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. So that's what grandma was doing. But you see a history of the Anglos doing this. They did this in Afghanistan to fight the Soviet Union. They kind of pushed this, like, this Taliban ideology to kind of radicalize the people in Islam, right? They try to use Islam as a way to fight against the Soviet model communism, but it backfired on them ultimately, right? So it's like they created the monster, and the monster comes and blows up in their face. And, you know, how many decades have they been in Afghanistan and they still can't tame the beast there? So it's like you see these unintended consequences that spring up. And I think one of them is that they're actually going to end up giving more of an ethnic consciousness to Hispanos. And I mean ethnic, I don't mean national. I think the level of consciousness that's coming in now, especially with us, the Pochos in the diaspora, is that, again, our national identities kind of, they become dotted. They're not so fixed. We realize, like, oh, you're not so different from me, you know, El Paisa from Antioquia, from, you know, El Güero from Jalisco.
Yeah, because we have the same ingredients. You know, the recipes use the same ingredients. Little variations here and there to make us, you know, somewhat unique in our own way.
Yeah, and we should be proud of that, you know, again, because in mestizaje that produced you from the Caribbean, you have that expression more of that African and the Taino. And it makes you different from the Peruvian, but at the same time, it's like you both have the same father, right? You know what I'm saying? And again,
right, exactly.
And so it comes back always to buffer and reinforce masculinity and the understanding that we come from our fathers, though we spring from our mother. The mother is the soil. The seed itself comes from our father. And that's an understanding that's been kind of covered up in contemporary society.
Yeah, they've tried to, you know, I think what they're trying to do now is they're racing the clock, right? Because of the demographic giant that we are.
Yeah.
And also that we could look in the rearview mirror and see tradition.
Yes.
For example, myself, you know, I might not come from the most traditionalist families, but there was still you know, spare the rod, spoil the child, right? Like, I used to get beat, and, you know, I thank my relatives for beating me because I learned a lesson, and I learned it quick. And, you know, I still pass that on. Especially with children that haven't reached the age of reason, they only know the difference between pleasure and pain. That's the only, you know, you can't really tell like a 1 or 2 year old, like, hey, listen, you shouldn't do this because it's going to have these repercussions and that is going to lead to that. You just got to smack the little dude.
Let me get to your eye level, Tommy. Yeah, go ahead. Let me get to your eye level, Tommy. And why don't you tell me how you feel, Tommy?
This is how white people raise their kids.
And I feel like they've been doing that for several generations, right? I mean, whereas for us, we're still doing it, or if we're not, we could just look back to one generation of not, I use that as an example, but of tradition. It's still within reach for us.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And I think that it's what you say. They are racing against the clock. But I just see it failing. And I think now with this whole election where they've marginalized Hispanics. They basically have said Hispanics are not loyal. They're not loyal to the Indigenous or Afrocentric worldview. They're still holding on to their traditions by voting for Trump. And now this, like the meme of the white Cuban. So it's like, if you're a traditional Hispanic, if you're a Hispanic who's connected to their roots and embraces their mestizaje, embraces the Spanish paternal line, embraces Christ and Logos, then you are a white Cuban by default.
Well, listen to what they're saying, right? If you prefer 500 years of culture and tradition over, like, you know, some corporate identity that we invited, that we invented, say, a year or two ago, you're wrong. Like, that's what they're basically saying. Like,
yeah, you're a racist, you're anti-Semitic, you're homophobic, you're misogynist. You're all the things that we know they're going to call us.
Yeah, put down grandma's home cooking and eat this processed, you know, crap right now.
This vegan, branded, Indigenous branded vegan concoction.
Soylent.
Yeah, made in...
Try the Soylent right here.
Made in a lab owned by Anglos. Somehow that's fighting against... That's decolonizing... people. That's exactly right. And that's where we're at.
You know what's funny about the decolonization theory is that the most important professors tend to be from, I mean, what two of the most important professors and ideologues of decolonization theory is one, Walter Mignolo, a professor from Duke University, and the other one is Ramon Grossfogel, who is a guy from he's from Puerto Rico, but he's probably like he has a Catalan last name, so he's probably descendant of like slave owners. But besides that, he's a professor in Berkeley, you know. Mm.
Yeah, these lame ass hippie ass boomers who got caught up in academia, and again, these are the only people who are allowed in academia. These type of voices, they'll never put voices like ours in academia. They're not allowed to. But, you know, again, these institutions that they own have expired. They're obsolete. Academia is obsolete. You don't need academia today. You just need the internet. And, you know, they're trying to close the internet down, but it's like, it's, you opened up Pandora's box. You can't put it back in. People are going to find a way to disseminate, information and media, no matter what they do on the platforms. Like, they'll just stop using the platforms. You know, I think Facebook has seen it. Like, who the hell uses Facebook anymore unless you're a boomer?
Wow. Well, I have a profile, but I'm 40.
I use
it. But do you
I use Facebook sometimes.
Do you use it as much as you use your other platforms, Instagram or Twitter?
No, but I think I have like a fair share of Facebook, so.
I think it kind of became like a phone book for me. Just a way to, like, you know, keep track of friends that might move. You know, like, oh, you know, I don't have this person's phone number. All right, let me look. Oh, yeah, there, we're friends on Facebook. Oh, what's your new number?
Right.
But, yeah. It's a little antiquated.
Yeah, it's just. It's
I know my son definitely laughs that I use Facebook. He finds it funny.
Right.
Venezuelans use. I think they're people from the third world.
Yes,
that's use exactly. Facebook a lot.
Yeah,
because they're a little behind, like we discussed before. The you know,
but
they're a little,
not even like the. Trends. Not even the elites of the third world tend to not use it. You know, that's a funny thing.
Yeah, they don't.
The elites don't. The ones that visit the U.S. Twice a year, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, basically.
They're up to date. They're up to date on it.
Rounding it back, I also wanted to stress the point that Spain, and I'm sure you guys will agree with me, but Spain was kind of like the last remaining country that really represented old, you know, Christendom of old.
Yeah, it did.
You know, at a time where the North was falling to heresy.
It was Spain and the Austrian Empire, pretty much.
Okay, yeah, the HRE, Austria in particular, of course.
Austrian-Hungary Empire. Those were the one, like, aims of Christendom in Europe.
Exactly. So another way to look at the Anglo antagonism is that they see Spain as the darling of the Catholic Church, you know, a country that's still what they would call maybe backwards, that still, you know, holds on to all the dogmas and that still is doing everything the old way. And I think a lot of the disdain towards Spain is rooted in that.
Yeah, of course. Of course. Yeah. With Spain,
the literature, North American literature and all that.
Sure. Spain is the embodiment of that. And that, so it's like the Indigenex, the Afrocentrists, and the Anglos are really in bed together fighting against this old
right.
conception of the world that right. I so, would call Catholic. So, it's universal of all time, right? Like the time in human history doesn't make it more or less true. It's always true.
Right. So you see, like, you could say something like this, like you see in Northern Europe, 3 million souls lose the faith. But dang it, here comes Spain converting 6 million across the oceans,
right.
You know,
right.
Making up for it. It's like, dang it. You know, like Satan, you know, Spain is like a thorn on Satan's side, you know?
Yeah. And I think this opens up really a conflict that. It's the battlefield. You see it in Europe. You see the conflicts between the Mediterranean nations and Northern Europe. You see it today. And I think we should definitely devote an episode to that because we have to understand that Hispanoamerica is an outflowing of the Mediterranean with, you know, Mesoamerica with the, all the other, nations and tribes and empires of Southern America. Whereas North America is an outflow of that which rejected that worldview. And historically, you know, the people from Northern Europe were essentially the slaves of the Romans. They were the enemies of the Romans. So these conflicts throughout history, it's like they've picked up new forms, but they haven't entirely ended, right? They just kind of evolve into new expressions. And you still see like a civilizational continuance through them, even in, you know, the so-called West, which likes to like claim the Greek Western tradition, the Greco-Roman tradition as its kind of birthplace. You realize that they've rejected that and they diverged from that long ago. And the logical conclusions of what they introduced to the world or reintroduced to the world is BLM, is Indigenexism. Is this LGBT two-spirited thing, you know, is feminism. It is all this stuff is the products of that rebellion.
Right. Right. They just keep coming out with new flavors, you know?
That's right.
There's just, you know, when one starts to lose steam, they'll come out with something else.
Yeah. And so I hope what we did in this episode was to again, give the listener the roots, the historical roots, the development of indigenism, political indigenism, and to understand how it positions itself as an enemy to you
And it's really a tool of your enemies that seek to give you this internalized schizophrenia, this bipolar essence where you can't reconcile, you can't be at peace being both, you know, Roman and Mesoamerican, right? They don't want you to embrace your native blood, and they don't want you to embrace your European blood and the fusion of those two cultures within the new world. And ultimately, that's only to serve our historical enemies. So they're afraid. They're looking at this demographic time bomb, and they're desperate. They're racing against the clock to see how to neutralize it.
One thing
that's pretty much it
is how much of a cardboard cutout it is. Like, was the other, like, was a black supremacy and the white supremacy? It's like, in essence, it's the same thing, but instead it's with brown skin.
Yeah,
you know, it's.
And I think it's necessary to highlight that the fact that they hate the mestizo. They don't like you. You know what I mean? They want to radically transform you.
Yes.
They want to transform what you are. They want to pervert. Like, they want to portray you as something that you're not. You know what I mean?
They want to box you up and put you in a corner, I feel.
Yeah,
because the mestizo is somebody that could reach, you know, he could grab from here, he could grab from there. He's a mestizo. And, you know, he's not compartmentalized enough to be used as a tool. So he's got to go into, you know, these little indigenous groups where he could be.
I think really.
I feel like they don't want you to have an integrated and holistic identity. Like, they want you to have that fracture.
Precisely.
Within yourself. They don't want you to be whole, because if you're holistic and you have an understanding of who you are, then you can't be controlled.
If you're whole, you're holy.
Yeah.
In a way, true. It's the stealing of a birthright. Basically, I don't want to tie it up with Israel and Esau, because Israel ended up being the heir.
Jake
threw away his birthright. Which we're
Jacob
not
and Esau.
Right. You know, they want us to throw away our birthright the way Esau did.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And they want to claim it, right? Which is why, like, you know, the Anglos like to LARP as Romans, even though, like, we're the ones who are actually related and descended from them.
Exactly.
And we're not allowed to embrace that. They don't even want you to embrace your Spanish heritage because you're not white. Like, that white, this is what Anglos do to us, right? They say, like, oh, you're not white, you're an Indian who was raped. And then what do the fucking indigenous faggots say? Oh, you're a poor Indian that was raped, come and become a transsexual like me, and we'll and we'll be able to expel this Spanish occupation from our history. But it's like they're saying the same thing, and yet they're acting like they're fighting against white supremacy, but they're the ones who are lending themselves to be tools of Anglo-white supremacy. So to hell with
that. And they'll say, come reject your God, too. They'll say, come reject your God and go worship Quetzalcoatl.
Right.
Quetzalcoatl.
But even Quetzalcoatl probably has a remnant of some kind of logos. Compared to what they're putting. So it's just, they're going to tell you Quetzalcoatl until Quetzalcoatl becomes a bearded man who's there to kind of set order into the world, because now Quetzalcoatl is suffering from toxic masculinity. And that's the real goal.
It's a cheapened version.
Yeah.
I think it's like a cheapened, like, watered down version of what the, you know, they actually believe.
Sure.
The actual indigenous beliefs.
And they won't, you see, like, first off, the people who believed it rejected it and became Christian. And they're the most pious Christians today.
Yeah.
More pious than the Spaniards. So it's like, you're not going to be able to recover that. But the reality is that their goal isn't to get you just to reject your Spanish heritage and the Roman legacy. Their goal is actually, if you're a man, is to make you a woman. They want you to become two-spirited, because masculinity is intrinsically European and white, right? That's basically what they're saying. So it's like, they're going to get you first to reject your Spanish heritage so that your son will reject his testicles and scrotum.
Mm. There you go. Baby steps. Yeah. Baby if you're not steps. Ready for the LGBT stuff, we got the little indigenous group for you to get you warmed up, you know? You can start there.
Yep. And the next one will be that. And then that's it. There's no more reproduction. And then now these Hispanics, these hybrids, are no longer a threat to jam culture. That's the gameplay.
Yep. Been neutered at that point.
Yes.
But, you know, I don't know if this is too simplistic, but at least, you know, if I could give one reason why these movements wouldn't appeal to me among many, it's just, it's obvious. Like, okay, if that's really how you feel, well, listen, get rid of your smartphone. Stop speaking a European language. That button-up shirt. It's gotta go. Oh, electricidad, running hot water. Like, no, papi, come on. Tú no eres indio. Come on, let's be for real. But they don't. People don't do that.
They're
not
down for it. Yeah, make me a basket. Make me a quilt. Yeah,
exactly. I don't think any of those.
They want. They're very specific in what terms they want to decolonize themselves.
Yeah, they really just.
Russia can only survive in the city. They won't. They won't make it even in the country, let alone in the actual wild.
No way you could be two-spirited and fucking make it through the warring Plains Indian tribes. You weren't going to survive being two-spirited, buddy.
They would have got scanned by one of the Comanches or something.
Hell yeah.
The funny thing is that they think that conception of sexuality pre-Columbian people had is the same as the LGBTQ conception of sexuality that modern gays have, or some weird shit like that.
Yeah, totally. They impose this racial worldview and this sexual worldview that is just a product of Western degeneracy.
The Aztecs put homosexuals on spikes, bro. Like, they literally... They literally impaled them. Yeah, they weren't down with that shit.
Women had no rights
them first before they go hunting for other tribes. They cleansed themselves. They don't money on it first.
Women had no rights under the Aztecs. The Aztec man had the right to have several women if he wanted to, and if a woman was caught cheating on her man, she was killed. they did not apologize. Yeah.
That's not going to work out for them in the long run.
Okay, folks, so I'm pretty satisfied. Unless you guys have some final notes you want to touch on the subject, I think it was an important download of information that we had to give the listener. But if there's any other notes you guys want to give them so that we can, you know, deal with this front in the culture war.
Well, all I can say is, you know, talk to your family, talk to your loved ones, to your friends. And just warn them about this garbage. And it should be pretty easy, to be honest with you. Because this stuff, you have to be young, you have to be very impressionable, and you have to have nobody that could teach you any better for you to fall into this garbage. So, you know, just look around you, check your circles, and make sure that, you know, people are not infected with this garbage. And if they are, just address it, you know. Be a man, do what you got to do, and talk to them. You know, don't make them lose heart, right? Don't go... so hard that they lose heart, but go hard enough that they don't, but that you get the job done, and that's it.
I think for me, like, coming into my own understanding of what it was to be a mestizo like myself, because más blanquito, you could say castizo, right? When I started forming an integrated identity where I accepted both and saw myself as Hispano, that's when I got the most pushback. When I was repping the USA, that was, you know, all good. It's cuando yo era, you know, Mexicano, even though, like, they would call me white boy, you know, at least I was Mexicano, that was fine. But once I said, you know, actually, my identity is much larger than that, right? It's an ethnic identity. That's when I got the biggest pushback from all sides.
From all sides.
I would say that is the biggest threat that they see, is that you have this integrated, holistic identity. They don't want you to have that. Nobody does, right? Because then you would know yourself.
Yeah, they don't want you to feel like a Roman Mesoamerican, because that's
they don't want Voltron to come together. Yeah. They want the little tigers to stay, you know, corriendo solito. They don't want Voltron.
Yeah, they want mm-hmm. you to feel like a victim of an abuse, of rape. They want you to be debilitated mentally and spiritually so that you don't offer competition to them.
I just want to say that this sort of like pan-indigenous identity makes no sense. It has no historical basis, no cultural basis, while the pan-Hispanic identity has a historical, cultural sense, and even a spiritual sense. And they're trying to deny what unites us, which is very destructive. And at the same time, they hate the mestizo, and they hate, which means that they hate us.
They see the mestizo as a whitening, Hanya. Like,
yeah, no, that's pretty much it. And they hate the implications of mestizaje. They view mestizo like they dilute the Indian racially. They don't go as far as they racially, although they say it when they talk about genocide.
But it's implicit. But,
yeah, it's implicit. It's implicit. They don't have the cojones to say that they hate race mixing, and they hate that you're diluting their precious Indian blood. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Anybody else? Fonz, you there? You want to give some?
Okay. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, like, to form an identity, just, you know, spend time with your people, your Dasa, stay off the phone, stay off the ideology shit for a little bit. I mean,
unless you're listening to our stuff.
There's a lot of information that's just going to confuse the shit out of people. You know, just spend around your people. I guess that's what I can say.
Yeah, I think there's actually a lot of wisdom in that, dude, because the reality is that what we put forth is not something that we've invented or concocted or came up with. It's just literally the observations of our people. This is our people, right? We are a mixed race people. We are people who lose. We don't view race, right? We view complexion. We don't view someone who's a slightly different color than us as a different subspecies of humanoid. No, it's just un moreno, un blanco, un indio, whatever the hell it is.
Yeah, un flaco. Right?
Yeah, exactly. In the same line as that, you know? But they're still relatives. They're still family of ours, you know? So I think what we put forth, again, is just an observation of what's already there. And actually, this is perfect to bring this point up as we wrap up, is that we have to understand that la Hispanidad is not an ideology, right? It's un hecho. It's a fact of history. It is what's happened. And that goes beyond right and left, right? La Hispanidad is a product of Rome and Christianity and the happenings of the Iberian Peninsula and how that spread out and then mixed in el mestizaje in the Americas and formed us. These are facts of history. This is not a political ideology. It's just realizing and now using ideological terms and intellectual language to share and express and understand ourselves. That's finally happening, which I think is
that's
good.
That's very important that you pointed that out, that it's not an ideology.
Yes, it's a fact of history.
And you know what I think is an also important thing to point out is that the casta system, right, you know how we've expounded on it, that there was this concept of calidad and the castas, you know, were fluid. But in a way, it was just a way that human minds were trying to categorize and understand this new race that was coming into being and the different variations of it. And that's what I think of when, you know, when I look at that. I just see it as, you know, people trying to understand this new mestizaje that they were making.
Yeah.
And have names and, like, you know, terms for it. But like you said, like, and like we've expounded on it, it was a fluid system where you could actually move up in the world if you were of a good moral character and you had success in life and, like, you proved yourself. to be a good member of the community and a righteous person. Like,
yeah. You know, no, it never,
that was more important.
The system never worked, you know, like it was unprecedented for the Spanish and for the Indians. And you saw it in that Indian that you referenced, the Inca, Haniel, where I don't think they understood how quick that mestizaje was going to take place. I don't think they knew that humans put together here were really just going to stop giving a fuck about kind of this racial view and just willingly mix the way it did. It happened very fast. And I don't think the powerful people were ready for it.
In regards to the caste system, I mean, it was a system to organize people in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century. Like, and besides that, current Native Indigenous people and Black poverty is not as a result of the caste system. This is mainly a result of the Criollo Republics that they didn't know how to incorporate those peoples into their state, because they already have rights, they already have property that they lost as a result of the independence. So it's not merely Spain's fault, it's also the Mexican, the all our states' fault.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah.
That's a good point.
Yeah, that's what I mean, where they brush a lot of the stuff that went wrong under the Republicans, they brush it into like the empire did that. And it's like, no, look into the history of that. That actually happened after it was broken up. But I think we're good. I'll leave it here. Thank you guys for listening. Thank you guys for participating. And we're looking forward to the next episode. Peace.